Just removed it.
Well, that would be a much more honorable thing than making an exception for
True.
Tom Kelly and Keith Bussey. You know?
That's right.
Well, the other thing was, would have been to it kind of weird because it puts you in a tough spot mm-hmm. when General Motors
well, right.
is telling them they have to move. We don't allow them to move.
No, well, there was no good outcome at this point.
That's why I stayed.
In the real world, I think you did the best you could, but as a matter of law, I just kind of don't like the idea that, well, it's the law until somebody comes along and says, well, I'm being hurt by it. And then,
well, like you say, it should never have been put in.
Well, yeah, and hopefully it'll get repealed. I mean, just otherwise, you
under general principles.
Want protection from Target.
Right.
And well, and a lot of these things could probably, I mean, for example, Mark and I were talking about this. If you were to open up a Subway mm-hmm. and you didn't want the National Subway, they didn't like the way you were running or whatever, mm-hmm. and therefore they wanted to put one in across the street, well, mm-hmm. you thought, well, why wouldn't you put it in your contract instead of doing the law? Put it in your contract that states that you...
Right. Why didn't you tell them that?
And we've already got,
I went around in 2001.
And we've already got zoning laws, there's only so much of...
Right.
You know, that kind of thing you can do anyway, and it wouldn't be to GM's advantage to have too many Chevy dealers too close together, unless, like you say, they wanted to get rid of one, mm-hmm. in which case they could do it anyway, just yank their charter. And
it's funny because my guess is it's not every day that dealerships move or relocate. Mm-hmm. It just doesn't happen very often. Obviously, Jim Kelly was there forever. Well, it's a big investment to mm-hmm. do that,
sure.
so they just don't pick up and move every now and then. Mm-hmm. And I think it's interesting that Evans Toyota has been around since the early 80s on mm-hmm. Coliseum. It's kind of the same North Automall. Mm-hmm. Roarman went in 90, roughly 91, somewhere in there. And, of course, they've been competing against, mm-hmm. but they weren't affected by the 01 law, obviously.
Right, yeah.
So,
I can ask you once we start too. But what are some of the other major bills that came through? I think we ought to talk about. So I don't catch you cold.
Well, Phil and I, we co-sponsored, but we had to put it down because it isn't of interest to anybody else. It just another magistrate for Allen County. So he was my co-author.
Yeah, that's probably...
That's not of interest to anybody, except to Tom Felt.
Well, Tom's probably happy for the help, right?
He's very happy, yeah. the inheritance tax.
Expressed do not necessarily represent those...
Okay. I probably won't mention it to you,
okay.
But then about 5 minutes, they'll probably, Ron will give me another sign. I'll probably mention about that point that we've got 5 minutes left.
Right.
So you know we need to start kind of wrapping up, and then probably with a minute to go, I'll kind of break in at some point because I'm going to have to do all the usual mm-hmm. closing stuff.
Okay.
And we'll have a brief, taped introduction, then I'll introduce you. Maybe the thing I can do to start the show is ask you each to name two or three bills that you think were the most significant of the session, and then we can get into a discussion of them. And I'm assuming Right to Work will probably be at or near the top, so we can talk about that and go from there.
I'll ignore that one. I'll ignore that one.
I won't let you.
I'll have some comments about it.
Okay.
The views and opinions expressed do not necessarily represent those of Access Fort Wayne, the Allen County Public Library, or any other supporting group. Get involved with Access Fort Wayne and make your own television programming. Call 421-1250 to find out more.
Hi, and welcome to the Fort Report. I'm Kevin Leininger, News-Sentinel columnist and reporter. And with me today are State Representatives Phil Giaquinta, Democrat from Fort Wayne, and Phyllis Pond, Republican from New Haven.
Right.
Welcome, both of you. Thank you for coming.
Thank you.
We recently finished the General Assembly session for this year. As usual, a lot got done and a few things didn't get done. So I thought this would be a good time to talk a little bit about primarily what did get done, what the main achievements were, and what you think the impact on Indiana will be moving ahead. So why don't we start by asking both of you to name maybe two or three things that you think were the biggest accomplishments that collectively you did this year.
Well, one of the things we did is we had the state fair stage collapse. Mm-hmm. That was very prominent, so we had to deal with that. And I thought we dealt with that very well. And then it's hard to keep track ahead of the drug dealers and the drug makers, so we passed something on the synthetic drugs that they're getting into.
Mm-hmm. Phil?
You know, I believe probably House Bill 1376, which was a result of, and kind of interesting, Phyllis and I will probably talk about this later as we move along, but why are we in a short session and what are we here to do? But this was a result of $320 million or so that mm-hmm. was over the summer that was discovered, and I think it was a good opportunity to decide what to do with that. And part of that, House Bill 1376, more grants were created to help continue our goal of fully funding full-day kindergarten. Mm-hmm. And I think that was pretty significant,
yes, right.
Really, for me personally, and it's something that I've talked about ever since I was first elected in 06. Phyllis is a former kindergarten teacher.
Right.
She knows
yeah.
the value of early education and
That's
things.
True.
And I really felt good about that.
Well, and obviously the schools have been struggling with budget cuts. Your brother's on the Fort Wayne School Board, so mm-hmm. he knows all about that. Mm-hmm. So I'm sure they were happy to get a little bit of good news for a change from
right.
Indianapolis.
Right. You know, Fort Wayne Community Schools have done a nice job over the years of, they've had to shift some money, some funds that were somewhere else and move. They were one of the early school districts to go to full day kindergarten, and they've done a nice job with, and more importantly, they've seen really great results. Mm-hmm. And I think that's really what we're all striving toward. So I don't know if every child in the state of Indiana is going to be able to take advantage of the grants or not. It's getting close. I know
it's
going to
get very close, yes.
Some schools just really, frankly, aren't prepared just yet, building-wise and maintenance and transportation-wise, but we're getting closer.
Some in the small school districts might not be able to take care of it this year, take advantage.
Now, interestingly, neither one of you mentioned the bill that got the most attention.
Which one was that?
What could that be? Right to work? And Phil, the last time I talked to you about this, I think we were both in a hotel in Illinois, where you and Wynn Moses were hiding out for a month or two. Didn't pass last year, did this year, which, if people don't know, right to work, it essentially says if you're an employee at a union company, you cannot be compelled to pay union dues.
That's true.
Obviously a big bone of contention on both sides. Phil, you were against it, obviously. Phyllis, I think you were for it. Why don't you both explain why you voted the way you did and what you think the short and long-term impact on the state will be?
Well, contrary to what some people are proposing or saying, the sky is not falling. That in 1995, we passed the anti-fair share for the teachers, and they've pretty well gone ahead like they were. Mm-hmm. So as I see it, I think it's going to make the labor unions more sensitive to the regular, worker?
I don't know what the outcome will end up being. We'll have to see. But in my view was, why are we telling a union and a business mm-hmm. what they can or cannot negotiate for? So this is actually a term that's negotiated between the union and the company. And so they negotiate, it's part of a variety of points that are negotiated. So they negotiate whether or not a fee can be charged to their employees to have representation. All unions by federal law are forced or have to represent everyone, be it in a grievance or a termination process or anything like that. So they have to represent everyone. But then to say that you don't have to contribute to that representation, personally I think is wrong. But again, to me it's up to that particular union to whether or not they want to negotiate that point. But now in the bill that was passed, we're saying that you cannot even negotiate that. So I guess it'll be some type of voluntary contribution. I don't know really how it's going to work. We'll just have to see.
And I think the union now will try it much harder to go out and actually convince those union members that it's to their advantage.
Right, and the argument for it, you hear from Chamber of Commerce and economic development people, is it'll make the state more attractive to would-be employers. The counter argument is it's a union-busting bill that'll drive wages down.
Well, I'm looking for those new businesses to come to Indiana. So I hope those promises ring true.
The effective date is probably what, July?
No, it took place in March.
Immediately?
Yeah.
So any way to gauge? I know it's very early, but
I read the article in the Indianapolis Star this morning that there was an expansion, but I can't remember the name of the company. And in the news release that the state sent out, one of their things they attributed to was the right to work. Now, the owner of the company said that had nothing to do with it, but he attributed it to the other things. So here we go.
Let the politics begin.
Right.
Yeah, I'm sure every company that expands now will be attributed to the new law.
Maybe, Phil, a question for you. I alluded to the exile last year, which I think maybe was not really feasible this year, given the new anti-bolding bill and the fines that would have been levied, or maybe it was simply a strategic decision you made not to do that again. But what do you think accounted for the relatively cordial session this year and the manner in which this was passed?
Sure, good question. You know, I think from the beginning, you know, we knew we didn't have the numbers. Mm-hmm. Obviously, it was 60-40, so. Our goal, our task, was really let's at least slow the process down, and let's give those that want to come down and testify the chance to do that. We had one committee meeting on the House side. It lasted 6 minutes, 6 minutes and 20 seconds, I think, which we thought was, and even Speaker Bosma said it wasn't our best moment, and he admits to that. So our thought was, well, let's give the public a chance to weigh in. Give those that are advocating for or against an opportunity to explain their side. And so we just really wanted to, frankly, just slow down the process a little bit, or it would have been done. Because there was just, you know, you hear all kinds of talk. You know, we had the Super Bowl coming up, and people, legislators wanted to get things done right away within the first week or two, and we were like, well, let's hang on here. So I think that was really our goal, was to slow it down and get more feedback and for folks to.
And then that way they were successful. They slowed it down. However, I know in their mind they also had this new anti-bolting law in mind, because if they're going to be fined after 3 days,
$1,000
a day, mm-hmm. that makes you think twice before you do that. We have to have something, and that'll be for Republicans too. That's for anybody that does that.
Well, Bosma's on record as saying he would never do that. So
we'll see.
Right?
Would never do what?
Leave the state.
Well, they've done that before.
They've
at least
gone
left
other
the city.
Places. Yeah, left from the city.
Yeah.
You have to have something so that one side, the side that is in the minority, can't stop the whole process. They can just stop the legislation,
right.
Which they did for 5 weeks, which is not good.
Well, Phil, I think it was you who mentioned the Super Bowl, or Phil, I can't remember, I'm seeing the moment. But it struck me that a lot of what was being talked about, at least to a degree, was done with the Super Bowl in mind. And I'm thinking, you know, the smoking bill, for example, that originally my understanding was it was something the NFL was really pushing. They wanted it in place in time for all the parties. That didn't happen, obviously, but it was still ultimately passed. I'd be interested in both of your takes on how satisfied you are with what finally came out.
Well, I've after observing the Fort Wayne smoking ban over a course of starting in the mid-80s throughout the 90s and incrementally getting to where we are, which is a complete ban, I think sometimes you have to be cognizant of where you are in the debate and the discussion.
Right.
And if you want to get something passed, then sometimes you have to write a bill to get that passed. And the only way, I think, to do it at the end was to include some exemptions. I mean, I think you have to be a realist sometime.
I
think this will
well.
This will come back over and over to include to include bars and so on. And from someone who, obviously, within the city limits, Phil Sandel lives in New Haven, but within the city of Fort Wayne.
My New Haven people are happy.
What's that?
My New Haven business people are happy.
Are happy. The bar owners probably are. So for me, it's the first step. We'll continue to look at it as we move forward.
But it may come to the local county or the local councils deciding where they want it in their county. See, that's kind of what we have now.
Well, right, and for a time, they were not going to leave that opt-out provision in.
That was yeah.
Ultimately, they did. So right. New Haven, which under the county ordinance decided to allow smoking.
Right.
In fact, I was just at the Treon Tavern last night enjoying a cigar. I don't think some of the bar owners would mind if it didn't exempt bars as long as they were
some
all
the
treated equally. But, you know, they say, well, if you're going to exempt casinos, which I haven't really heard anybody who wants to take that on.
Right.
So how do you justify including bars when you don't include casinos or VFWs or you name it?
The only way you can do it is let your local government decide. And that's what I think we should do with fireworks and smoking and things like that. Because counters are different.
Well, Phyllis, you answer me this. You know, Indiana residents in their infinite wisdom elected a predominantly Republican legislature, you know, pro-business, freedom-loving libertarians, and yet, you know, you've just passed a bill that limits freedom, no matter, you know, for better or worse.
How
did that happen?
That's kind of hard to explain, because I've always been a freedom proposer, and it's hard to accept on the health issues. Mm-hmm. But I would favor a bill to let each community decide. That puts the pressure back on the local units of government.
Yeah. As Fort Wayne did.
Well, it also helps out. A few years ago, Farm Bureau came into a committee that I was in and testified for to allow smoking. Mm-hmm. So afterwards, I said to them, who do you represent? Because the people I represent don't feel that way. They said, oh, yeah, but we got a lot of tobacco farmers in southern Indiana. So I would guess that the counties in southern Indiana would allow smoking.
The libertarian in me says, why not leave it up to the bar owner, for example? Uh-huh. You know, put a sign by the door. If you walk in, you know you've got a smoking bar. If you don't,
just come to New Haven.
Well,
that's what they've done.
You can't do that in Fort Wayne, though.
I know, but the owner of that, Anderson, Mr. Anderson, spent about $1 million.
Right.
On getting it as smoke-free as possible. Mm-hmm. So, and you can't smell it very much out there. Unless
although
you
we won't
right
let you smoke a cigar in there.
Yeah, so. Yeah. Well, those cigars. I would go for eliminating the cigars, yeah.
Has anybody ever done a study on economic impact on Indiana one way or the other?
They probably both have. They probably both come out different, depending on which side you're on.
But Phil, I think you alluded to it, and obviously this will come back again probably next year in a slightly or not so slightly stricter format.
Yeah, I think as we see the economic impact that Fort Wayne has encountered, and really bars, more and more bars are going to non-smoking. I think the slippery noodle down in Indianapolis and others, and those things are just sort of starting to take care of themselves. But I think for me anyway, it's a health issue. I mean, I go back to no shirts, no shoes, no service, and that was a health issue, and so you have to protect public's health.
Incrementalism, though, ends up sometime costing companies more money than if you would do it all at once. For example, you know, the Fort Wayne ban, and you mentioned Rack and Helen's, but, you know, they responded to the law change in Fort Wayne on the theory that proved true that people would be coming out from Fort Wayne. And a lot of the Fort Wayne bars, when we had the old law that you had to have a separate smoking, non-smoking area, spent a lot of money putting in separate areas that as soon as they passed the law we now have became obsolete. So,
but I think there are more and more people, though, that like to go into a non-smoking restaurant.
Sure.
And so those people will be coming back to those Fort Wayne restaurants or to the ones who don't have smoking in them.
Yeah, and that's a market decision which even a good libertarian like me would applaud.
Yeah, so. I would like to see the results of studies too to see if those people are coming back.
Mm-hmm. Well,
we'll see.
Why don't we move on a little bit to a bill that, Phil, I know you were a co-sponsor of, dealing with location of auto dealerships, and in particular, the Kelly dealership, Kelly Chevrolet, move from State to what they want to do, Lima Road by I-69, which is being really done at the behest of GM, that's told them, we really would like you to move. Where you are now is kind of cramped, hard to get to, obsolete. So they are between a rock and a hard place, so they either have bought or put an offer in on the land, the old Seifert plant. And now, lo and behold, Summit City Chevrolet, their chief competitor, has invoked a little known, certainly to me before all this came up, state law that says you cannot locate one Chevy dealer or any other make within a 6-mile radius of another. So take it from there. What did your bill intend to do?
And sure. Yeah. Fortunately or unfortunately, I was more than the co-sponsor, I was the author. And essentially, I'm going to take you back a little bit to back to 2001 when the 6-mile idea was first started. And essentially what the car dealers wanted was some protection from the manufacturers that maybe were not happy with a particular auto dealer and how they were operating or something like that. I wasn't there in 01, so I'm not really sure the exact debate. And so my bill did not change any new entry points of 6 miles. That stayed the same. But the idea was, let's make it 4 miles, and you have to be further away. So you have to satisfy 2 points. So to address this specific situation that you're referring to, Kelly on State Street is approximately 4.1, 4.2 miles away from another similar Chevy auto dealer on Illinois Road.
Right.
Frankly, they used to compete when they were when Summit was DeHaven on Calhoun Street,
right.
and Kelly was on State. So they were about 2 miles apart, mm-hmm. and then they moved farther away. Well, Kelly is actually moving farther away to their new location than they are currently. So the idea was that you had to satisfy both requirements. And we were talking earlier, kind of just put us in a tough spot, because this is something where General Motors is requesting this as part of their restructuring that they did. And certainly we're trying to help out an existing dealer that's trying to do what they're being told
right.
by General Motors. And I think most of us thought, well, since they will be farther away, and there are certainly other auto dealers, I call it the North Auto Mall on Coliseum and Lima Road, that are competing with similar, I can think of, there's a Toyota dealership on Coliseum and Lima, there's a Toyota dealership on Illinois Road. They're both competing with each other, so in my mind, they will still be able to compete and move forward. And frankly, will probably help, I think, all Chevy, I'm talking too much, I know Phil's attorney, but I think in the end, we'll draw more, because we just don't drop in and buy a car. You shop around. You say, oh, I really like this Trailblazer. I'm going to go check the other place that sells Trailblazer. I'm going to compare and shop. And a lot of people are doing. They're going across state. Sure. They're doing over there. It has changed now how the world of buying cars is. I just hope this helps.
And to be real truthful, though, I think we should go down there and repeal the whole law, because the law is not right. It should have never been put in 2001. We have no business protecting one business.
No,
I don't know.
Well,
I don't know how it happened.
Well, maybe I should ask Phil or you, either one, but why didn't somebody propose that this time around, which may have
Well, he was in the debate. I don't know. Did anybody propose that?
It was asked, Senator Banks asked me that in the Senate committee, and I said I'd be certainly open to looking at that next year. And as we stated earlier, with smoking ban, you sometimes you have to get what you can get, and I will tell you that it would have been difficult, because auto dealers around the state would have started leaning on their reps and senators and say, you know, we want this to stay in place. I had a hard time getting this through as it is, and so it would just, Kevin, it just frankly would have been tough to get that passed and accomplish what we were trying to accomplish with Kelly.
But it's pretty hard to justify, because we don't protect Kroger's and Meijer's and say you can't build next to them. So.
Well, and time, I think, was a little bit of the essence here, correct? Because you've got the lawsuit pending by Summit City, which This is really intended to put a stop to and allow Kelly to move.
Right.
So.
Well, they've been in mediation since February. The lawsuit started last summer, last fall,
late fall.
So they and we gave them till the end, till a little bit later, enactment of January 1, 2013. So they have the rest of the year. If they want to be serious about negotiating something, they certainly still have some time.
Will the governor sign it?
Oh, I think so.
Yeah, I think he will. I checked today, and I don't think he has yet. But I think it's seven days. I think, right, I think so. We'll see.
If he does,
signing a lot of bills lately. Yeah. So.
Getting hand cramp.
Or it could just become law.
That's true. He doesn't have to sign it.
That may happen. Well, I just don't think the legislature should be in their arguments like that.
Well, it's interesting because what's across the street from every Walgreens
is another drug.
CVS. So, so I'm not sure why some people are frankly scared of competition and why we put up barriers of your of miles and stuff.
Well, Phyllis, you were there when this passed. I know that was a while ago, but you recall.
Guess what? I don't recall it even passed. It passed probably when they both agreed.
I looked at the bill, and it's actually a small line among, and so I'm going to stick up Burbs in the pond here. It was a one-liner among a bunch of other things. It was an omnibus bill, that carried a bunch of things in there. And so, frankly, it might have even been added. No, it was in the House bill that went to the Senate. And so, because I did look at it.
Because they probably says it doesn't make any difference. So. It probably just passed.
Great point, because I don't know if we knew that we'd be back here
at that time,
10 years later dealing with General Motors and others, car deal restructuring and going through those types of things.
At that time, it didn't matter.
Right, yeah.
Well, and this may happen other times here and probably in other towns. I mean, we used to have a lot of kind of central city dealerships that have now almost all moved out to the suburbs. Mm-hmm. So if there are any left, it may come up again, and certainly in other towns and cities, I would think.
This
that
only
would
applies to counties of 100,000.
Correct.
So the smaller counties basically only have one dealer anyway.
But some of the other areas where it might affect, if it does come up, they're going to want a similar kind of.
Remember, 4 miles, and you have to be farther away. So we did put a little some stipulation in there that made some people
done a good job in crafting that.
Well, let's move to from the sublime to the ridiculous, maybe. Girl Scouts. I know neither one of you probably, thank God, were directly involved in that, but Representative Morris probably opened a bigger can of worms than he wanted with his letter about not signing the resolution. Took a lot of heat, a lot of laughter, I don't know.
I think he's wiser. I think he's wiser.
Older and wiser, yeah. I'm sure he would do it differently. And I won't necessarily ask each of you what you thought of it, because I think I know.
Well, let's say my daughter was a Girl Scout. I was a Girl Scout leader. I was a Cub Scout, then mother. And so I just think the Scouts do a wonderful job.
This was two sessions. One was the first half with Right to Work, and then everything else. And some people thought we should have gone home right after Right to Work. We could have saved Representative Morris from whatever you want to call
it. But, I mean, I think there was two serious sides to it. And I even wrote about it, and I think he went about it wrong. I mean, if you look at the literature out there, and a lot of people have, at least at the national level, I think he was right up to a point on some of what he said. But he didn't make that delineation clear about how it affects the local level, which everything I've ever been exposed to through family and friends is a perfectly fine organization. Plus, I'm sure it must have had an impact on how you all did your jobs down there, right? I mean, what was it like of days?
It did take time. Mm-hmm. And that we probably should have been spending on something else.
Well, the problem is, I mean, do you serve on boards, Kevin?
All the time, yeah.
I'm sure we're right. I do too. Uh-huh. I mean, so you and I probably, who knows, maybe one day we'll serve on the same board or something. But we may have different views on subject X. Well, that doesn't necessarily reflect how that organization feels on that. I noticed that before the show comes on, it says this program does not reflect the views of the Allen County Public Library. So to sort of kind of link what is happening in potentially one part of the Girl Scouts or something, and I don't know all the details, then to brand the whole organization, I think, was the
wrong way to go. I was not even aware of that, what he was saying, until it came out.
But I'm sure you're right. I mean, he's learned a hard lesson, but, be careful of what you say and to whom you say it before you open your mouth. We've only got about 4 minutes left. Let me go through a couple of things fairly quickly. Vouchers have been in place now about a year. In your estimation, how are they working or not?
Well, what I hear, they're working well in most places. There are some schools that are having to change, but I think they're working well.
I'm not sure what the definition of working means. For example, are they being used? Is that the question? Because you could have a student who is doing great, making great grades in the public schools, but for some reason decide they would like to go to a different school, parochial school, for example. Mm-hmm. So they use the voucher and they qualify based on income and they go to that school, continue to get A's. So I'm not really sure what mm-hmm. we accomplished there as far as grades, other than that person, for some reason, that student wanted to go to a different school. I think there have been some interesting questions that have come up. For example, what if that family's in, what if they hit the lottery? Mm-hmm. What happens if they start to, they now make more money than where we were? Do they have to go back and take a year of public education before they qualify again in case their income goes down? So more questions are starting to crop up.
Well, Phyllis, you're a former public school right. teacher. I mean, do you worry about what the impact on the public education might be of this? Or do you think the argument for it is that the competition will help them improve?
I think the competition will help because we didn't have any trouble with it in East Allen. Now, I know that there may be some parochial schools that have been holding back to see if it's working, mm-hmm. and they may take it next year, so we'll see.
Well, I think the Catholics in Fort Wayne hit it a lot harder than the Lutherans, so we'll have
to... The Lutherans were to stand back and watch, see what happens to the Catholics.
Yeah. Well, we're always a little bit behind the curve.
Right. So. Cautious.
Real quickly, we only have about 3 minutes left. You mentioned, Phil, earlier, full-day kindergarten. Has it... Again, another one of those has it worked questions, but has the experiment with full-day kindergarten to date justified the additional money that...
Sure. Oh, no doubt it has, really. I mean, if you look at the test results, test scores, and how kids are doing in Fort Wayne Community Schools, because mm-hmm. they've been started this, I think, back in 2006 or 2007, mm-hmm. So we're starting to see good results. But there's no question that, and in fact, Indiana, I think we're now just one of 10 states that doesn't provide money for preschool, and I think that's where we're going next, pre-K, because that's there's no question. Again, results, and I'm going only by the statistics that I've seen, that it really proves out well that kids start to develop their learning skills at an early age of kindergarten and even before that. So I think once we start putting some money toward preschool, we'll see even better results.
Okay. Real quickly, look into your crystal ball for next year. What will be the big topics?
Of course, budget. Mm-hmm. Budget, taking the money that we have and spreading it around mm-hmm. to cover everything.
Yeah. I think it's a great question. I really do. I haven't heard much from our governor candidates. It's going to be exciting because we're going to have a new governor. Mm-hmm. We may continue. I don't know. I doubt it, but we might continue on the path of some more government reform. I don't know. There hasn't been a lot of appetite for that. We're going to have a big, sizable turnover
yes,
in the legislature next year. So that sometimes can slow things down as new legislators are learning the ropes and the process.
And the revenue going to be tight again next year? Or
I think so. Okay. And the DCS, Child Services, there's a big controversy over that, too.
Yeah, and there's a summer study committee that will take a look at how we're doing, how this hotline is working, and I think it's a great
idea.
That'll
probably be the big issue.
Well, I think I need to end it there. I appreciate you both for coming in. I'm Kevin Leininger for the News-Sentinel. Welcome to the Fort Report again next week, and check us out at www.news-sentinel.com. Thank you.
What channel is that?